Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. This is Eric, your California driver. Today is the much awaited 10 tips that will help you become a top earner while driving DoorDash. Now, as you can see from my total trip deliveries and rating, as well as my wife's trip deliveries and rating, that this is not our full-time job. If you're looking for someone who does this full-time, maybe look somewhere else. But if you're looking for information on how you can maximize your earnings while you're on the road, while you are supplementing your income, you have come to the right place. Without further ado, here are your 10 tips that will help you make more money while you're out on the road. Tip number one is know which hours to dash. Now, this might seem like common sense, but common sense will be your best friend. There are really just three main times of the day that are highly profitable for you to dash. Those are from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m., from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., and from 5 p.m. to around 10 or 11 p.m. Now, it doesn't take a genius to know what these times correspond to. That's your breakfast, lunch, and your dinner rush. Now, you might be saying, Eric, but how can I do this full time if there are only three different times of the day that are really profitable for me to do? Well, I would say if you're looking to do this full time, even just for a short-term basis or on a given day that you have an off day, my suggestion would be that you work from 11 a.m. to around 2 p.m., then take about a two-hour break to have lunch or an early dinner and read a book or something, and then drive from around 4 until 10 or 11 p.m. That way you can use the bulk of your time actually delivering orders rather than sitting in your car hoping that you'll get one. This is my suggestion, my opinion. I live in Los Angeles that is traditionally busier than other states might be. These are the hours that I would suggest that you dash if you're looking for a full-time job. I've had a few comments from people working in New York City, especially what's going on right now with the quarantine, that basically they're saying you can work 24/7 and make $2,000 a week. I totally get it. There are certain pockets of the country. Los Angeles is a great example. For me, I tend to just stick to the evening hours when I know everyone's home, I know everyone's ordering, and the traffic is gonna be much lower. All right, number two, and there's a strong misconception that what I'm about to say is not true, but I can promise you, I can assure you that this is correct. You need to respect yourself and decline unwise orders. Your acceptance rate on the app does not determine if you are able to receive a trip. It doesn't determine whether you'll get kicked off the app. My acceptance rate has dropped down into the 20 percentile a few times. I think my wife, she showed me hers last week, is like 19%. It does not matter. There is one side of the coin that says if you hit these certain parameters, you can get VIP status, which allows you to get larger orders as well as being able to go online whenever you want. However, in order to get there, you have to accept every single $3 crappy order, most of which are not going to include a tip and are just simply not worth your time. A few years ago when I started doing it, the base pay, the lowest you could get per order, at least in Los Angeles, was $5.50. Now that was when they were eating into your tips. A lot of times you wouldn't be able to know how much a person had tipped or didn't tip. There would just be a $5.50 guarantee that you'd make, and sometimes you'd get more than that. But now it's gone as far down as $3. And if you're getting a stacked order or a double dash, that base pay is just $2. Just quite frankly, it's not only embarrassing for the customer, but it's also offensive to you as a driver. Like, you have to value your time enough to recognize that that is not worth your time. And if you're relying on people to tip you on the other end, hoping that if you take these $3 orders that, you know, you're probably gonna get a cash tip, I can tell you that's not always the case. The younger generation, they don't carry cash, right? I hardly have cash on me myself. So I can promise you that's not the way to the promised land when it comes to DoorDash. You wanna make sure that you're accepting orders that make sense. You know, you have to look at the mileage. Just because it's an $8 order, but it's gonna be 10 miles, it's not gonna be worth your time. You have to factor in how much you expect to make while you're on the app. For me, I expect to make between $20 and $25 an hour when I'm working just by myself on one phone. I know you've seen my videos where I work on two phones and we've achieved almost $40 an hour a couple times. But if I'm working by myself, I'm working for $20 to $25 an hour, which should be, at least in Los Angeles, is kind of the standard. Not like the gold standard, you can do better, but that's kind of the standard for me. If I'm making less than $20 an hour, it's not worth my time. So I have to evaluate an order before I take it. Is this going to help me achieve my goal, right? So I'm gonna need roughly 2.5 to 3 orders an hour, around $7 each, in order to reach my goal. So if I'm accepting $4 and $5 orders that aren't gonna be able to be stacked, how am I going to reach the goals that I've set for myself? Number three, and there are definitely a few people that will disagree with me. You can leave me something in the comments if you disagree with any of these tips. Schedule dashes in the area in which you live. Now you're gonna say, whoa, well, Eric, I don't live in an affluent area. You know, there's places near the city that I live that I can drive 20, 30 minutes to, and I can make way more per order than I do in my, you know, my little podunk area that I live in. I totally, totally understand that. So if you're doing DoorDash, chances are you probably don't live in one of these affluent areas. So I understand that it's probably going to be unlikely, if you're watching my video and you live in Los Angeles like I do, that you live in Santa Monica or Brentwood or Westwood or Beverly Hills. Chances are you don't live near there. For me, I'm about 25 to 30 minutes from those areas, right? So I have to factor in, I expect to make $20 to $25 an hour. If I were to say, you know what, I'm gonna drive in Brentwood today. I'm gonna drive from 5 to 10 p.m. in Brentwood, where all the rich people live. I think I can make more than $20 to $25 an hour working there. You have to factor in the fact that you're driving 30 minutes there, 30 minutes back, not to mention using your gas. So in a 5-hour stretch, if I'm gonna drive for 5 hours, I have to make at least $25 more in, now I'd be only driving for 4 hours, in order to be able to make it worth my time to drive all the way out there and back. Does that make sense? So from a time equity standpoint, the only way it would make sense to drive to one of these richer areas is if you can assure that during the same amount of time that you're going to dash, that you're gonna make at least an hour's worth of pay on top of what you'd normally make in the area that you dash. For me, it makes sense. I don't live in one of these uber rich areas that I'm not getting $20 handshakes from people after I bring them their meal. And I'm okay with that. I know that may happen in some places, but I'm okay living where I work. And that way I can literally turn the app on from my house and just start going. That leads me into tip number four. Tip number four is to turn your dash on before you even leave the house. Before you're even prepared to walk out the door, turn your app on 5 to 10 minutes before you head out the door. And here's why. Usually, not always, usually as soon as you turn your app on, the first 2 or 3 orders you're going to receive are orders that have been bounced around to all other drivers that no one wants to accept. $3 orders, or you know, $5 or $6 orders with long driving distances that no one else is willing to accept, are gonna come through to your phone first. You have to make sure that you decline all of those, which is okay. Just, you know, just like we talked about, you gotta be picky. And once you've declined some of those, you know, you'll have about 5 or 6 minutes, brush your teeth, do your hair, throw on your clothes, keep your phone on you, and wait until you get an order that's worth your time to accept and go out the door. If you don't get anything for the first 10, 15 minutes, guess what? You're still in your house. You haven't left. You're still working. You can lay on your bed, watch TV. You don't have to drive to a hotspot and sit in a parking lot and wait for an order that's worth your time, right? You're still on your time doing what you want to do. So as soon as you accept that request, you can finish getting ready. You know, 5-6 minutes, you're out the door driving to the place. And you know, I know there'll be some hecklers that say, well, that's not fair to the customer to keep them waiting. But I can assure you that at least 80% of the time, if you drive to the restaurant, you're gonna be waiting there for 5 or 6 minutes anyways until the food's ready. So keep that time to yourself, turn your app on, accept your request. 5 or 6 minutes later, you've got yourself dressed and ready to go. You're out the door, and you're still probably gonna be waiting for that food for a minute or two anyways. No customer is gonna be unhappy, and it won't affect your standing or rating on the Dash app, because as long as you're delivering on time, which you still will, you're gonna be picking up roughly on time and dropping off in plenty of time, you'll be just fine with your ratings, and you haven't wasted any time out on the road. Tip number five, and this is really important to making sure you keep your rating high. Because of the way I operate, I tend to be running a razor thin line of on-time delivery. I try to get food to people as quick as I can, but oftentimes if we're running on two phones, we can be cutting it pretty close sometimes. The customer can see where you are at, and knowing that they can see where you're at, They can tell if you're sitting at the restaurant waiting for 15, 20 minutes. They don't know what the heck you're doing. They just know that you haven't started heading their way with the food. Your job as the Dasher is to make sure you communicate with your customer, make sure you're on the same team with them, that they recognize that you're in it for them, and you need to let them know, hey, I'm at the restaurant. This is what I do literally every single time. If I get to the restaurant and the food is not immediately ready, I text the person and I say, hey, I'm here at insert restaurant. They haven't finished your order yet. As soon as they do, I'll be on my way. Thanks for your patience, right? Period. Send off. The customers appreciate it. Either they say nothing in return, or they say, thank you so much. Don't worry. Take your time. Either way, they know exactly what's going on. They know that you're there idling, waiting for their food, and it's not ready. Does it lead to more tips? I don't know. I could say probably, because they're going to feel bad, especially if you're waiting 5 or 6 extra minutes on top of the drive for the food. But at least they know that you're not lollygagging and wasting their time. Second thing, once you have the food and you're on the way, as soon as it's safe to do so, between around 3 to 6 or 7 minutes before you're about to drop off, send them a text and let them know when you're going to be there. So if your ETA says 4 minutes, send them a text and say, I will be at your house in 4 minutes. Thanks! Exclamation point. Send. Guess what this does? 70% of the time when you get to the house, they're already waiting outside for the food. Yes, I understand that they can see where you're at, and you know, if they're super hungry, they're going to be out waiting. But I can't tell you the number of times before I started doing this that I get to the house, I can't find, you know, especially if it's an apartment complex, I can't find where it's at, gate that's locked, or there's big dogs outside. If you let the person know the exact time you're going to be there, 70%+ of the time, they're either going to be waiting on the street for you, or they're going to be walking out of their house as soon as you pull up, because they know that you're coming. And why is this important? Well, 2 reasons. One, you don't have to worry about entering most people's yards with a big dog or trying to get through their fence and, you know, they're jerry-rigged, whatever, that they have their fence closed. Especially if you live in an urban area, you'll know what I'm talking about. Everyone's got a fence in their yard, in their front yard. And 2, you're going to save between 1 and 2 minutes at every single house. Now, you add that up and extrapolate that over a night. You know, if I did 15 deliveries, that means I saved a half an hour. I was able to get 2 more deliveries in than I may have otherwise been able to do so, because this residual waiting and waiting and waiting for people that you don't really think about on an individual order, but I'm telling you, it adds up. If you get to the house, they're not already waiting and you don't have immediate access to their front door, meaning that you haven't parked on the street and you can walk directly up to their door unimpeded. There's a fence, there's a dog, it's an apartment complex, you didn't get the number. Call immediately. Don't wait and just hope they're gonna come out. They're not gonna be annoyed or bugged by it. And remember, this is your time that you're talking about. As soon as you get to the house, if you don't see the person, you can't get immediately to their door, there's something in the way, call them and let them know you're outside. If they don't answer, text them. If they don't answer, call them again. They're not gonna be bugged by this. Remember, they were the ones that ordered the food and they wanted it quickly, right? It's called DoorDash. If you're there at the house and they're not waiting for you, that's on them, and we need to resolve that. Remember, as long as you have an order that's undelivered, you can't get new requests. So every second that the person is holding you up is an extra second that you're not able to get requests for your next dash. As we've mentioned a few times now, your time is super valuable. Tip number 6 is do not be afraid to cancel an order. It is important that you do not waste your time. The only thing you have when it comes to this job that can set you apart from other people and help you improve how much you make is your time. You have to do everything you can to maximize your time. I'm going to give you 2 scenarios which I feel that it's acceptable and in your best interest to cancel an order. And I would not make a habit of this, because it is important that you have your completion rating at around 80 or 90% to be in good standing on the app. Unlike your acceptance rate, which does not matter at all, your completion rating does matter. I would say use this sparingly, but definitely use this when it's going to benefit you time-wise. So scenario number 1, a restaurant like a McDonald's or a Burger King or a Taco Bell or a Wendy's is operating as a drive-through only due to, you know, the hours that you're picking up or due to what's going on right now with quarantine issues, and their lobby is completely closed and you have to go through the drive-thru. You've accepted, let's say, a decent order, a $7 order for McDonald's drive-thru. You get to the drive-thru and there are 10 or 12 cars in the drive-thru line. Now, for $7, do you think it's going to be worth your time to spend 15 to 20 plus minutes in this drive-thru and then take the food to the customer? Do you think that's going to be worth your time? Depending on where you live and your cost of living, the answer could be yes. In places like Los Angeles, like I said, if you're not making around 20 plus an hour, then you're doing it wrong and this is not worth your time. In that scenario, it would be okay to cancel the order, at least in my opinion. I'm not saying never accept a McDonald's order or a Burger King order when they're operating as drive-through only. I would say if you're close enough, accept it, drive by, you know, if it's 2 or 3 minutes away, drive by and see how long the line is. If it's only two cars, awesome, jump in line and get your order. So it's kind of a case-by-case basis. Scenario number two, where I think it's totally acceptable to cancel an order, we'll use Wingstop. Wingstop's a good one. You go into the Wingstop, you show them the name, they say, oh, it's not gonna be ready for 15 or 20 minutes. If you're gonna be waiting 15 to 20 minutes for an order that pays $6, $7, $8, is that going to be worth your time? I would argue the answer is no. So in that situation, I would text the customer immediately and say, hey, they said your order is going to be about 15 to 20 minutes. I'm going to cancel, so the next Dasher is going to be able to accept and they'll come and get your order. Thanks so much. Cancel. That's all you have to do. It's not rude. It's not going to make their food be delivered any later, and it's going to save you time so you can accept an order that is going to be ready sooner. Tip number seven is to strive to accept orders from restaurants where you traditionally get a double dash or a stacked order, whatever you like to call it. There are a couple restaurants in the areas in which I live. Little Caesars certainly is, Panda Express certainly is, and you could probably think of three or four others if you've been dashing for a little bit, that you've been excited to find out typically when you accept an order from here, that you'll get a second order while you're at the restaurant or on your way to the restaurant. This is really fruitful because you're able to double your output in the same amount of time or add just a couple minutes. Sometimes you only have to go a couple hundred yards out of your way to deliver that second order. The other night, I accepted an order from a hole-in-the-wall Japanese restaurant I had never heard of before. Pay wasn't bad. I made like $7, right? Awesome. It was kind of out of the way from where I wanted to be, but it wasn't too bad. Decent $7 order. What would be worth it to you more? Let's say that order only paid $5.50, but if I cancel it, I got an order right after that from Wingstop or Little Caesars for $5. What do you think is the better value bet for your time? Now, granted, I typically don't take $5 orders anyways, but what would be the better value bet for your time? Probably the $5 order from a chain restaurant where you're likely to get a second dash on top of it that's gonna be going the direction you're going anyways. Even if it only pays $4 or $5 as well, you're now making $10 on two orders rather than $6 on one order, and it's only gonna take you a couple minutes longer to finish. You're gonna get the food at the same time. It's definitely the way to do DoorDash. I'm not saying never accept orders from these hole-in-the-wall places, but brand awareness is super important, right? There's a reason why Little Caesars is a nationwide chain, because it has brand awareness. That means it has more orders per day than this, I can't even remember the name of it, this hole-in-the-wall Japanese place. I'm sure the food's fantastic. My likelihood for getting a second dash from a hole-in-the-wall restaurant as opposed to a nationwide brand is much lower. And so make sure you are prioritizing, even if you're accepting orders from these nationwide brands at a little bit lower rate than you would traditionally do, but you're risking it because you've studied your area enough and you know that traditionally these are places where you can get a stacked order. There's no way for me to know what your area is like. I only know what my area is like, and I've studied and memorized every restaurant in my area that takes DoorDash. At this point, every once in a while, a new one will pop up. If you'll do this, you will definitely make more money if you prioritize taking orders from restaurants that you can double dash. Tip number eight, this is something I just started doing recently. I found it to be pretty effective. It's helped me to keep track of all my orders. And I think in the long run, it's gonna help prevent me from getting blamed if something in their order is not what it was supposed to be. Have a pen or a Sharpie in your car or that you carry with you to be able to write the customer's name on the bag. So I know most restaurants, they'll either have a receipt taped to it that has the name, or some restaurants will actually have a label. Some, they'll write it on the bag for you, or if you ask them to, they'll do it. But not every restaurant does. And so what I like to do, especially when I'm driving with two phones, and there's times where I've had four orders at a time in the car, I need to make sure I never screw up an order, never screw up a drink. If I got a cup, they've given me a cup holder and I have two orders and each of them have two drinks, two of them are Dr. Peppers and two of them are Cokes. I need to make sure I remember which ones go to which order. It's easy to forget after 10 minutes. Even if you think, okay, I got this. It's easy to forget. If you have a pen or a Sharpie's probably better for you to be able to write the name of the order on each cup. That way when Steve gets his food, he's not saying, hey, you didn't get my blank, right? Or hey, this isn't my order. Well, Steve, your name's on the back. This is the food they gave me. So you're always gonna cover yourself and you're gonna make sure that you never make a mistake. Okay, tip number 9, and this is going to be a little bit counterintuitive. There may be some people that disagree with me, but do not park at the hot zones. Now, I understand, let's say you live in some place in rural America and there's only one place in your entire area that has Dashes, one shopping center, whatever the case may be, this rule might not apply to you. But if you live in any urban to suburban area where whatever Dash area you're gonna be in, there's going to be multiple hot zones at any given time, do not park in the hot zone. Leaning up against the restaurant is not gonna give you a greater probability of getting that Dash over a person a couple hundred yards away from you in the same shopping center or half a mile away. What I choose to do is to put myself in the best position where the greatest number of restaurants are in a close radius. So in my particular Dash area, there's a shopping center that has about 5 or 6 restaurants that use the DoorDash platform. And then about 2.5 miles away, there's another shopping center that has about 5 restaurants that use the DoorDash platform. Rather than parking in the parking lot at either one of them after I finished a Dash somewhere around there, I go roughly in the middle. I found kind of a couple streets that I like to just park and wait on, and I'll park in the middle. So I'm about a mile from each of those places. That way, I increase my likelihood of getting an order that I think is worth my time from one shopping center to the other. And guess what? Within that sphere that I've now created, there are actually a couple of other restaurants that also lie within that perimeter. Now, if you're too far away, at least where I'm at, your situation may vary. If I'm more than like 3 miles away from one of the shopping centers, I won't get any Dash requests from there at all. I have to be within a close enough range to be able to get them. I'm not sure what that range is. I just know that I can get them from my house because I'm within 2 miles of both of those places from my house. And I can get them when I go to the place that's pretty much right in the middle of the two of them. This way, you're never waiting long for a request that's worth your time. I don't know where the best place for you to camp out after you finish an order is. I tend not to park at all, right? Usually I'll finish and within a minute or two, I'll get another Dash request. But if I've been waiting for 2 or 3 minutes, I'll start matriculating to the middle of those two shopping centers. Number 10, and last but certainly not least, is to frequently update your location data. That means if you've gone 3 or 4 minutes without a request, turn your app on and off. Pause and unpause your Dash, put your phone into airplane mode and take it off again. These are suggestions that DoorDash actually tells you to do within the app. Why do you have to do this? If you've driven long enough, you probably recognize there's a time or two where you started getting an influx of orders that were for restaurants that were nowhere near where you live, like 12 miles, 14 mile deliveries that were so far away from your current Dash area. Why does this happen? When you're sitting in one place for a long time, usually it's not a problem. But if you've been driving around a lot and your information's bouncing off different cell towers, sometimes your location data can get a little bit confused and the app gets thrown off a little bit. Sometimes it might not even think you're in the Dash area at all. So you have to make sure that if you've gone 3 or 4 minutes without receiving a request, close the app down, pause and unpause your Dash, turn the airplane mode on and off, and reset your location data. There are times where my wife and I do this 10 times per night per phone when we're out driving. This you could call maybe tip 11, but it's not really last but not least, and this is not tip 11 really, but just some words of advice, is love yourself enough to not get bullied by customers. Don't let yourself get bullied by employees at restaurants that think that you're beneath them. And don't be discouraged by these low paying orders coming through and thinking that you just have to accept them in order to make any money. In the turbulent times that we're living in, I understand that signing up to DoorDash may feel like a step back for you. You know, the progression that I wanna be on and where I wanna end up in my life, this is not really what I want to be doing full time as a 34-year-old man with a college degree, but I understand that it's a means to an end. If you treat it like such, if you treat it like a job, because it definitely is, if you love yourself enough to not accept terrible orders and to not allow yourself to get pushed around, you're going to have a good experience, you're going to make more money, and you're going to realize that this is exactly what I said before. This is a means to an end. This is not the end for you. And if you're working with your goals in mind, this is going to be an enjoyable opportunity for you and an enjoyable part of your life. Thank you guys so much for watching. Don't forget to like the video. If you're not subscribed to my channel, please subscribe. Feel free to use this content. You can share it. You can embed it on anything. This is free. I don't care what's done with it. I think it's very important that whether you're using DoorDash or Postmates or Uber Eats, I think these skills are pretty much transferable on any of those platforms, Grubhub included. I just hope that while you're out, you recognize that there's enough room for everybody. There are enough decent orders for everybody to make money, especially with what's going on right now while everyone's in their house and everyone's ordering food. I hope that you have a good experience out there. If you have any comments or concerns, if there's anything that I've said in this video that you disagree with or you feel that you want to correct, feel free to leave a comment below. Again, I recognize that every area is different. The things that are going on in New York City right now are probably very different from Bozeman, Montana. The DoorDash experience is going to be reflected in that. So as always, God bless you. Have a great day. Have fun out there.